I'm trying to figure out exactly how to do this without like blowing a blood vessel in my brain. This is so good. It is so good, the words of Christ that we're going to look at today. Every word of Christ is good and holy and relevant and profitable for us. But this is just this little brief text following the Beatitudes, and it's verses 13 through 16 of Matthew 5. Would you do me a favor, congregation, and just stand up? Let's honor those that gave their lives to bring us the Word of God. 13 through 16, Matthew 5. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. And all God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. God always blesses the reading and the hearing of his word. So in Matthew 5, 13 through 16, Jesus has likened us as Christians to salt and to light. What is it about salt? What is it about light that led Jesus to compare us as his followers to them? One thing for sure, absolutely for sure, is salt left in the salt shaker does no one any good. And light turned off does no one any good. So what I want us to do today is I want us to figure out how we can, by the power of the Holy Spirit, commit, covenant, recommit, recovenant, if you will, to get the salt out of the salt shaker and to shine. I was really overwhelmed with this message this morning as I was praying and I was asking the Lord, God, just fill me up. I don't want to drop the ball on presenting your sermon. That's really what I'm doing. I'm preaching a sermon from his sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. And it's a tough act to follow. Because Jesus Christ was the greatest preacher ever known to humanity. Amen? And where is this coming from? It's coming from a passage. Remember, one of those sections, one of those teachings, one of those passages. There's five of them in the book of Matthew. This one's the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5, 6, and 7. And so I'm just so excited about, I feel like this, I not only feel it, but I think it. I think and I believe this is the message for the church in America today. It is. All of our societal ills in our country today, I believe, church, you can link back to the church in America not being the church. You can link it back to the church, Christians, not being salt, and Christians not being light. I want you to think about it as we go through the sermon today. But I don't want us just to abstractly think about, you know, those other carnal churches out there. You know, those church over there. I mean, they're not following God. They're not, you know. I don't want us to think as much about that. I believe that's a reality. I want us to think about our church, but more importantly, ourselves individually. Are we being salt? Are we being light? Now, obviously, the Lord, when he says, you are the salt of the earth, you are the light of, you know, of the world. He's not literally saying that we're salt or literally saying that we are light. He's speaking metaphorically. You remember in your English classes, a simile is when you use like or as. A metaphor is when you simply say you are or I am. Like when Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Did he really mean he's a loaf of bread? He did not. He meant he is our sustainer. He provides for us. I am the door. He's not a wooden door. He's speaking metaphorically. So when he says, you, Christian, are the salt of the earth, you, Christian, are the light of the world, he's speaking using metaphors to refer to us. Somehow, when he uses metaphors, it drives the point home better than if he just came right out and directly said, bump, 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 bump. Now, what I've done is I've gone through and I've exegeted these verses. I mean, I have studied them backwards and forwards, original language. I have really, really, really thoroughly exegeted this passage. But I've also looked at some intrinsic qualities about salt and about light, made some observations about salt and about light that I think maybe can give us insight of how we can be more faithful to get it out of the salt shaker and to shine in this very tasteless society and this very dark time in which we live. You've got the text open right in front of you. It is the Word of God. It is without error. And God wants to transform us with it. So first thing I want to ask is there a parallel between Jesus' words about salt and about light for us as Christians? Is there a parallel to what James, the half-brother of Jesus, you know, he did have brothers. He did have siblings. Contrary to false doctrine out there, right? Amen? Do you believe that? So James was a half-brother of Jesus, and James wrote this book under the inspiration of God. And James chapter 2, do you see a parallel between James chapter 2 and Matthew 5 verses 13 through 16? Does anybody see it? Let me give you the Reader's Digest version of James 2. James said, hey, faith without works is dead. So you have some heretics, that's what I call heretics. You have some heretics out there saying, look, 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 see, you got to work your way to God. You got to work your way for salvation. Their religion's built around that, right? You don't say so many Hail Marys. You don't genuflect just right. You don't, how many of my Christians here today from a Catholic background do we have? Look at that, y'all. You know what I'm talking about? Domino's Pizza. let me just say, I am grateful to God, to my brothers and sisters in Christ from the Catholic background who have found freedom by faith alone in Jesus Christ. You ready? That I join hands with in pro-life causes. Amen? Isn't that beautiful? We prayed for our brother, Mr. Hauk, who was arrested for doing what? Being a pro-life Christian Catholic who was praying and defending his son in front of an abortion clinic. And was vindicated, by the way. It's just, I get excited about that. But back to James 2. James says faith without works is dead. He's not saying you got to work your way to heaven, or somehow your faith plus your works saves you. We're saved by grace through faith apart from works, but we are saved to do good works. Amen? Look at verse 10. Don't forget Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, and then 10, because we are supposed to work, and that's what James is talking about. I believe that's what Jesus is talking about in Matthew 5, 13 through 16. when he says, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. So watch this. I do a lot of works. My wife and I love working for Jesus. We love working for you. We love giving our lives for the kingdom, right? Work, 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 work for the Lord. I love it to be used of the Lord. And I know you love it. You're so involved, church. You're so involved. I just look around at this congregation and I just see an insanely beautiful amount of works going on, but not to be saved, but because you are saved. You got to make sure and keep it crystal clear. So James and Jesus, though, I think are saying something. That we're supposed to translate our genuine faith into genuine shoe leather, into genuine works. I think that's what he's really screaming out at us. Now, let me give you a quick background. So, hang on one second. Let me unveil my props for today. Oh, look, a dove. No, it's not that. You have these moments as a pastor. I used to do a thing called Pastor's Pals. You know, the kids come forward and then the pastor talks to them, gives them a little sermonette, you know. I tried to do a little illusionist type thing, and my sweet wife, she put it together for me. Let me just say, I have no ability with sleight of hand whatsoever. And I was traumatized for years following that. The kid saw everything. And if you can't fool, you know, anybody else relate to what I'm saying? Okay, a few of you. All right. Where am I going? Look, it's not the salt that really Jesus was referring to. It's a lot different than our refined sodium chloride that we can buy in the grocery store. So historically, what it was really all about was they would find a kind of a marshy area that was salty, contained a lot of sodium chloride, and the salt would kind of over time compact down, and so there was a lot of this vegetative type material that was kind of intertwined, interlocking, fibrously interlocking the sodium chloride. So what they'd do is they'd go in there and they'd cut blocks of salt out, they would transport it, and they would store it in some sort of a space that they would hope to keep dry. You know, you didn't want water hitting it. And these blocks were, Jesus is saying, you know, he's talking about these blocks of salt, and he says, you are the salt of the earth, verse 13, but if the salt has become tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. So what he's referring to is what the people he was talking to would see, is if some of that salt, let's say, was exposed to a leaky side of a shack where they were storing the salt blocks, you know, you could still have this block that was intact, and it kind of looked like a block of salt, but all the sodium chloride had leached out of it. And what they would do is they'd take those garbage blocks of salt minus the sodium chloride, and it was worthless. They would put it out just on the path. And that, he says, it's no good except to be thrown on the ground and trampled on by the feet of men. What is this saying about Christians and civic responsibility? Church family, thank you for not leaving me when I faithfully and biblically spoke to the issues of the day in our country from the Word of God. Like the prophets of old did, you didn't abandon me. In fact, you brought more people to hear the preaching, teaching of the Word of God. Thank you. But what does it say when Jesus says you're the salt of the earth, you're the light of the world? What does it say about our civic responsibility? Wednesday evenings, we teach a biblical citizenship class. We're exploring that. How many of you have attended that? Isn't that awesome, y'all? It's incredible. You feel like we're all around, and we're right there in the beginning when we saw the founding. Well, we didn't see it, but the founding of one great nation under God. Turn in your notes. Let's look at some qualities about salt. Salt, it seasons. So we as Christians should bring taste to a tasteless society. I need some help. Where's Sammy? Sammy, where art thou? Are you? Oh, there's my buddy. Everybody give Sammy a round of applause. Come here, Sammy. Come. Right up here. All right. Have y'all been in Italy for a while or something? I've missed you. All right, hold your hand out. What's this? Let's pull that nice sleeve down. All right, put a little salt there. Go ahead and touch your tongue to that. Oh. All right, big round of applause. Thank you for illustrating, young man. I got permission from mom and dad. Anyway, salt gives taste to a tasteless society. I know I don't want to dredge up what is the most painful thing for all of us and the world and our country, but have some of you still not quite got your taste or smell back following COVID? Anybody else? Okay, I see a few handfuls. One of you shared with me how, I mean, it was unbelievable period of time and just no taste, no smell. Well, I've noticed my taste buds, I seem to need more salt than I did before for it to taste the same as it did before, before I got COVID back a year and a half ago. But it's interesting how that is. I understand the scientific reason for that, by the way. But salt gives taste to a tasteless society. I've been transparent with y'all about my struggle, my battle, and many of you face the same kind of battle with food addictions, and it's been my entire life experience since I was 35 to really physically stay fit and not just allow myself to get really way, way, way overweight. So anyway, I'm right now, I might be like the reformed alcoholic, but I'm not an alcoholic. I'm not addicted to alcohol, but food really is a powerful, addictive force in my life that by the power of Jesus, I'm getting victory of. Right now, I'm in a victory phase. Amen? Thank you, Lord. But my diet is consisting of 80% raw fruits and vegetables for the last month. And one of the things I've noticed is if we're not careful, we get into a rut, a pattern of processed foods. And you notice processed foods are really high in salt. That's part of their trick to addict us. Well, salt and sugar. That was a secret for Poncho's Mexican restaurant. Are they still around? Anybody ever been to Poncho's? I led a manager of Poncho's to Christ 25 years ago, and he took me on a tour. Let me tell you what they had big 50-pound bags of. Salt and sugar. No wonder I would feel like comatose and half dead for 3 days after I would eat there. Do you remember the little flag? And Angela, she said, forget all that other stuff. I want the sopapillas. Salt brings taste to a tasteless society. But where I was going with the whole vegetable thing is, vegetables have a healthy amount of salt in them. I know some of you salt your grapefruit. That's a fruit, and you put salt to bring the flavor out. Tomatoes, anybody salt your tomatoes? Yeah, I get it. Well, when I'm doing a stir fries, and my sous chef is assisting me, that's Angela, by the way. I'm doing a stir fry. I'm making some organic vegetable soup, and we're cutting all this stuff and putting it in. I'm noticing you have to put more salt in it. And that's partly an age thing, but a post-COVID thing, and it's not that processed food. How many of you have ever heard this? We need to be more tolerant of everyone. Has anybody heard that? I think we would, all of us, agree that we need to show tolerance when we understand what tolerance really means. Of everyone. I get that. I think you get it. But I think why you groaned and why I groan, true salty Christians groan, is What we don't want to do is be tolerant of every person's sin, including our own. I don't want to tolerate sin in my life. And quite frankly, Paul talked about in Corinthians, he says, don't you dare tolerate sin in the local church. It doesn't end well. So I think really what we need to do in being salty, being salt, is we're adding taste to a tasteless society. My thinking is that society is tasteless because the church has become tasteless. The church is not salty. You can't really tell the difference between the people inside the four walls of a church building and the people outside of the four walls of the building. See? And it's impacting society negatively. Salt, number two, cleanses. So we as Christians should be used of God to clean up society. Did you know that? We're supposed to clean up society, Christian. We're to clean up society, church. That's part of what it means to be salt. When my kids were young and growing up, you know, if they'd get a sore throat, I would have them cleanse their sore throat by taking some warm water, mixing a little bit of salt in there, and I'd have them gargle. How many of you have done that or did that with your kids? But it's true. You see, you can cleanse bacterial and even viral type infections, at least on the surface, using salt. We, as salty Christians, are supposed to cleanse society. I'm going to take a survey. How many of you think the modern day church in America is doing a good job cleansing society? I don't think so. Now, one hand went up. All right, I know it's going to seem a little gross to some of you, but I'm kind of holistic in a lot of my health practices. How many of you kind of relate to that a little bit? Okay, you do too. This is the sacred bowl in my household. This is used on the rare occasion that I get a sinus infection. I fill it with warm water, warm to hot, and then I put salt in it, and I mix it up really good till it's dissolved. And then over the sink, I go like this and I stick my nose up to it and I suck the salt water up into my sinuses. You guys are looking like, ew, gross. Oh, yeah, right. This is cheaper than that massage or whatever that thing is. How many of you seen that thing advertised? You plug it in, you're like, yeah, it's gonna blow your brains out. It works. Yeah, look, see? Okay. Hey, I got an idea. You know how some of those charismatic churches? Okay, we're not that. We love the Lord. I was thinking we could have, didn't you say he was your dancer? We could have some kids dance down the aisles and splatter the whole congregation with salt shakers to make us more salty. Okay, or not. All right, wow. There's not going to be a part two. Salt preserves, so we as Christians should be a preserving agent in society. How many of you believe we should be a preserving agent in society? How many of you believe the church in America has been a preserving agent in society? Every good dad's got to teach the kids to hunt. Do we have any dads that would say amen? So we went out and we shot Peter Rabbit. But we also had a rule, if you shoot it, you eat it. You don't just do it for sport. And I mean, come on. Given to us for food. So you want to teach where the cycle is, that they're, you know, that meat that you get on your hamburger, that actually comes from an animal. It's called a cow, you know. But we shot this. We shot this rabbit, we butchered it, and we ate it. Ask me what it tastes like? Chicken. Chewy chicken. Anyway, Kristen, I think, said, Daddy, this is when she was a lot younger. Now she's mature and she's married and has a wonderful husband and all that. But this is when she was real small. She goes, Daddy, I want to keep the fur. And I said, okay. So we started showing them how to clean it. You know, you skin it and then you sit there and you scrape it and you go through the process. Well, one thing, this is kind of cheating a little bit for you peltiers or whatever you're called, but basically what I learned, my dad taught me, was you sprinkle a generous amount, you tack it out on a board, and you sprinkle, when you're done, you sprinkle salt on it. And that salt will kind of at least preserve. If you don't want to go through the whole tanning process or whatever, you can use salt. We forgot to put salt on it. And it was in the half-car garage at our house. And it was like, oh my word, it stinketh to high heaven. There's, you've heard, somebody tell me where this quote came from. There's something rotten in Denmark. Thank you, my English major. So, that was my daughter. Shakespeare, Hamlet, there's something rotten in Denmark. I want to declare to you, church family, fellow Christians, there's something rotten in our country. It's rotten to the core. And unfortunately, it's real easy for us to point the finger at them there crooked politicians. And believe me, they deserve that, many of them. Praise God for some of the good ones, right? Some of the righteous ones, I thank God. We better pray for them. But it's easy to do that, right? But what's not easy is to deal with the three fingers pointed right back at us. The reason the rotten politicians get in is because of corruption in the church. Corruption within Christians' lives. Corruption. Christians are not living. They're not acting salt, like salt. They're not preserving society. Do you agree with that? I know it's convicting because it brings it down to, wait a second, I'm a Christian. Am I being salty? Wait a minute, I'm a Christian. Am I in some way preserving? I want to tell you about a woman in our church that Angela and I, many of us, have grown to love and respect. Her name is Audrey Werner. And I would like for us now, if we can, let's show a video clip. And I want to talk about how she's being preserving salt.
Know that we're somebody's daughter.
The power of the nuclear family.
That moral compass is 180 degrees off what it was 50 years ago.
We're being led down that path.
Hey.
It's all connected. The signing of the Humanist Manifesto. A Nazi German scientist befriended Alfred Kinsey.
Drag your kids to pride.
It's a new thing.
It's less stigmatizing than other terms like pedophile.
John Dewey went to Russia as a special guest of Joseph Stalin.
Fatherlessness is undoubtedly the root cause of crime.
We do not value life.
I don't see that ending well.
There will be enmity, war between Satan and Eve C. This is the hour where America can turn on a dime and point towards the bum line again.
That one in our midst is being salt. Audrey Werner she works a full-time job. You saw all those credentials behind her name. She works a full-time job, but she's investing almost equal to another full-time job in a ministry to be salt, a preserving agent in our society. After the service today, you can see her. I think Deborah Hughes will be standing with her, but there is this resource that is coming out. You saw it there. That was a trailer that is really addressing the issue of this corruption and degradation that's occurring within our society right now. But it's not just pointing out the problem. It is a solution-driven approach. Look at your notes with me. The fourth thing about salt is it's supposed to create thirst. So we as Christians should live our lives in such a way to make people thirsty for Christ. I want to keep asking, how do I do that? How do you do that? How do we do that as Christians? Create a thirst in people. You know, you eat a salty pizza, you eat a salty bag of peanuts or popcorn, and whenever I go out and I eat Chinese food, man, after that I'm so thirsty. And I understand there's a lot of sodium in the food. Or we've got this favorite Mexican restaurant. After the service, you can ask me where it is, but the food is so good. It's in Melissa, and it's Mexican food, and it's reasonably priced, and I promise you, they put a lot of salt on it. So we love every bite, but then after the meal, I find, whoa, I get a second glass of water. Whoa, a third glass of water. So salt is supposed to create thirst. The fifth thing about salt is it melts ice. So we as Christians should be used of God to warm up cold hearts. Our wonderful treasurer, Hobie Miller, love him. He's our brother in Christ. He lugged this down for me, but in the wintertime, in order to keep it safe coming into the different buildings on campus, he buys a bag of pool salt. It's cheaper, you know, and he basically, it can be thrown out and the salt will melt. The salt will melt the ice. We are called upon, church, we are called upon, Christian, to warm up people's hearts to Jesus Christ. You know, to melt those cold, frozen hearts for Jesus Christ. Light, he says, not only are you the salt of the world, but you are the light of the world. And he says, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. So you're the light of the world. And I started thinking about it, you know, as Christians, we come in all shapes and sizes, and you know, but we're all called to be light, the light of the world. Maybe a year or two ago for the men on Father's Day, I always go out and I buy these things I think men will like, different kinds of tools, or I think I had one year they had five things they could choose from. And I always go into Harbor Freight, by the way, a good steward of God's money, and they're already selling it dirt cheap, you know. And I always negotiate at half price because it's for Jesus and the church. Anyway, anybody on Father's Day here at the church, do you remember, did any of you get this light right here that's burned out? Right there. Did anybody, any man get, there's one. Oh, there's one out there under the awning. I see that hand, the great throng in the foyer. No. Look, we come in as Christians, we come in all sizes and shapes and personalities and all of that, but what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to actually turn on the light for Jesus. He says you don't want to light a lamp and then put it under a basket. Now, this one's got holes in it so you can kind of see it, but it definitely mutes it, right? It definitely mutes the light. You don't want to put it under a basket. And it got me thinking about something. By the way, church treasurer and finance team, I borrowed an offering basket. So anyway, y'all, what I got to thinking, you know, about that first point, light reveals dirt. So we as Christians should live our lives in such a way as to convict people of their, what do you think that word is? Sins. And most importantly, of their need of a savior. The sin fixer is Jesus. I I preached this sermon about salt and light in 2013. And when I preached it then, I brought an illustration. By the way, my wife keeps a very, very clean house, and I'm grateful for that. But no matter how clean you keep your house, trust me on this. If you have sunlight coming through a window, and the bright sunlight is coming through and hits just right, what do you see, ladies, all over your house? You see dust. Don't look under the bed with a flashlight. I'm looking for something. And the point is that light reveals dirt. We should live our lives in such a way that people, when they see us living a godly life, a light-filled life, a holy life, right? What should it do? They should be convicted of their sins. And then it got me to thinking about something. Just as the salt, you remember those blocks they cut out and there were vegetative layers in it and all that, and if the sodium chloride's washed out, it's worthless. It got me thinking about light. What is it? What's happening in our country? What's happening is professing Christians and church members across the country, they're watching the same TV shows, they're going to the same movies as the heathens. They're no different. They're sinning. They're not keeping short accounts with God. And I started thinking about it. What blocks? Look, you're born again in Christ. If you put your faith in Christ, nothing you can do takes away the fact that the light of the world, Jesus, has saved your soul, your spirit from hell for all eternity. You're going to go to heaven. Would you agree with me? You truly cannot lose eternal life. If it's been imparted to you and it's a gift and it's promised by God, you can't lose it based on your earnestness or lack of earnestness, right? However, my problem is you have a bunch of Christians that really the basket that's blocking them, the light that's emanating from them because they're in Christ, that basket is really essentially unconfessed sin. What do you think? It is sin in our lives that keeps people, lost people, from coming to Jesus. Would you agree with that? Because what is the number one objection when you're sharing Christ with someone at work, a neighbor, maybe a lost family member? They're not going to accept your Jesus. They're not going to come to your church because the church is filled with a bunch of... You understand what a hypocrite, what they mean is that the church is filled with a bunch of non-spirit-filled, sinning Christians. Self-willed, sinning Christians. I am so grateful. My family, we're all so grateful to serve a community of faith and to be a part of a community of faith where I really sense there's a desire not to allow sin to be unconfessed. But, and I think maybe, just looking, I think maybe that's a reason why the church has doubled. It's not just because we kept our church doors open. That was big, yes. But don't you think maybe people see authenticity, but at the same time they also see hypocrisy? And I think there's a lot of authentic Christians that God is banding together. Any of you have heard the term remnant? I really kind of think the Holy Spirit in our country is raising up a remnant of true followers of Jesus Christ. And I see, honestly, I see that I'm shepherding a church that could be said to be a remnant of the true church in America. Turn to the last page in your notes. I told you there's not going to be a part two, but we'll be out at 3 o'clock today. You may be preaching at 3, Pastor, but I'm going to be taking my nap. Light brightens a room and keeps you from stumbling, so we as Christians should do the same. We all have a common problem, I'm sure. How many of you have ever gotten up in the middle of the night and it's dark, and you stubbed your toe on the corner of a chest of drawers or something. Man, I hit it so hard one time. And I got some big feet and big toes, but man, I hit the edge of the door jamb, getting up to go to the bathroom, and I hit it so hard, it took 4 months for it to heal. I think I broke it. You know what I mean? It kind of is a little crooked now. I don't know. How many of you can relate to that? You know what I'm talking about. Light brightens a room and it keeps us from stumbling. Lost people, folks, are stumbling around in the darkness. What are we doing about it? What do we think about that? We have the light that can brighten their way. We, Christians, have the light that can brighten their way, so they can see the straight and narrow path. They can see Jesus Christ. I'm thinking about light, and I'm thinking about, I don't know about you, but I don't want to let any sin in my life. I don't know if the cameras can come over here for our television audience, but I'd love for them to see it as well. We have a couple of construction lights that I'm using in the building. So before time change, more times than not, I would be working on the building after dark. So I would get up here and work before it was light, and then I would work and it would be dark. Now that time change is occurring, praise Jesus, I'm getting home before dark. It just feels better, but this is one of the construction lights. This is the kind of light-filled Christian I believe the Lord wants us to be. What do you think? Look at that. Okay, you're not hard convincing.
Put your feet wide apart and no.
Okay, turn the lights off, V, on the cross up there for a second. Can you do it? You see it over there? It says cross. Hey, okay. Now watch this, y'all. What are we supposed to do, man? We're supposed to have light shining. Go ahead and turn the lights back on. We want all the lights we can. Wouldn't it be cool if every one of us in the room had some of those powerful LED flashlights and we whip them out and we all point towards the cross? Isn't that what we're really supposed to do as Christians? We're supposed to shine the way, brighten the path so people will come to Jesus Christ. That's what we're called to do. Make no mistake, that 22,000 square foot building over there, that sucker's going to be too small if we will be salt and light. Do you believe that, Christian? Light gives warmth, so we as Christians should warm people's hearts to the gospel. My next door neighbor has about 100 chickens, and it doesn't bother me at all. I absolutely love hearing that rooster roost. I get up, by the way, before the rooster starts roosting, or whatever he does, cock-a-doodle-doing, or whatever a rooster does. There's about 100 of them over there. Well, during the wintertime, I noticed my neighbor, he's got this movable big building for all those chickens so the coyotes won't get them and they won't freeze and all that. He turns, you can see this red heat lamp kind of glow inside his chicken coop. And let me tell you, he's doing a doggone good job keeping those chickens alive. But how is he doing it during the dead of winter? He's doing it with light. Light, one of its qualities is it gives warmth. We need to bring warm up to the cold hearts of lost people in our country. Last point I want to make, but light wakes you up. So we as Christians should awaken people out of spiritual apathy and darkness. You know what happens when the light comes in, you know, or you're trying to kind of amp down, you know, it's 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night. What do you want to do? You want to turn most of the lights off and just kind of have a little bit of like a lamp going, because light wakens you up. Light suppresses the production of melatonin in your brain. So at night, you don't want the light real bright. But during the time for us as Christians, we need to be bringing light to people who are spiritually asleep. Wake them up. Warm them up. Right? Brighten up the room. Illuminate the way to Jesus Christ, the cross of Christ. We are the salt of the world. We are the light of the world. Let's do this for the glory of God. Let's say, Jesus Christ, we want to confess to you, you are the head of the church. This church at Stepping Stones, Jesus, you are the head of every true local church. You are the head of the universal church, the body of Christ worldwide. Jesus, we want to obey you. We want to be salt. We want to be light. Help us. And Jesus is yelling, screaming back to all of us that will listen. In holy love, he's saying, you ready? I left you the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will give you everything you need to empower you to be salt and to be light. Folks, we are waging a winnable spiritual war. Wageable and winnable. We can win it through Christ's way, Christian. We can be salt. We can be light. But it's only when we recognize our utter dependence on God Almighty and we say to him, we can't in our own strength, but we can through you. Because we can do how many things through Christ who strengthens us? Amen. Would you bow your heads and your hearts with me now? I want to give an invitation. Y'all have been phenomenal, incredible, listening to the Word of God. I told you I was wound up. All heads bowed, all eyes closed. First, an invitation. If you're watching this on our television broadcast, YouTube, Rumble, Facebook Live, some other mechanism, you're in the foyer, you're under the awning, maybe you're in your car, you're in the sanctuary, wherever you're seeing, you're hearing this message today, I want to appeal to you. Do you know for sure that you are in Christ? Do you know for sure that if you were to die today, that you would go to heaven? Do you know for sure that all your sins have been forgiven? That when Jesus said to all Christians, you are the salt and you are the light, do you know that he was speaking to you? Because he was only speaking to his kids. So maybe I should ask too, do you know for sure you're truly a child of God? The Bible says, but as many as received him, that's Jesus, of course, he gave the right, the privilege to become the sons of God, even to those who believe on his name. The Bible says we've all sinned, we've all fallen short of God's standard of perfection. The Bible says the wages of our sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Further, it says in Romans 5:8 that the wages of our sin is, it says that God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. One of my favorite verses in the Bible, whosoever calleth upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So if you're here, and maybe you're not here, but you're watching this or listening to this, and you don't know for sure that you're a child of God, that your sins are forgiven, that you'd go to heaven when you die, I want you to receive Christ today. Would you do that? Please. Pray a prayer like this. It's your faith in Jesus Christ alone that saves you. Not even the nuanced words, but it's your heart. He hears the heart cry. If you want to receive Christ, pray this prayer of faith and mean it. Say something like this, Lord Jesus, I know I've sinned. I know my sin separates me from you. Right now I ask you to take away my sin and to give me eternal life. Jesus, save me. Thank you, Jesus, for forgiving me of my sins and giving me eternal life. If you just prayed that prayer of faith and you meant it, with heads bowed and eyes closed, slip up your hand right now. If you just prayed that prayer of faith and you meant it, raise your hand high. I want to see your hand and pray for you. I see your hand. God bless you. You can put your hand down. I'm so happy for you. Is there someone else? Christians, I told you, it was a powerful message preached by Christ that we are salt and we are the light of the world. What did the Lord say to you? What did he say to you? Wow. I know he was speaking to my heart all week about it. He was speaking to my heart again this morning about what it means that I am salt and I am light. What implication that has in my life. What did he say to you? I'm pleading with you. Please give an answer of yes. Yes and amen. Whatever he said to you, say yes and amen by the power of the Holy Spirit. You will do it. Right now, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I want to ask you, did God speak to you today from this sermon that Christ preached nearly 2,000 years ago about us being salt and light? Raise your hand up high right now if God spoke to you today. I'd say 2/3 of the congregation, half of the congregation's hands going up. God bless you. Father, in the name of Jesus, give us the power we need to be the salt and light that you've decreed us to be. We love you, Lord God. I love you and I thank you for the privilege of serving you and your church here at Stepping Stones. Continue to bless our efforts as we seek by the Holy Spirit to expand your kingdom. Right now, we ask you to be with the gift and the giver as we return a portion of what you've blessed us with in tithes and offerings. In the peerless, the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Men, if you'd come forward to receive tithes and offerings.